Good afternoon from the Gambia. My name is Kyaria Tijalo. I'm your session host for this talk. The talk is going to be on privacy risk and general privacy regulation compliance. The talk is going to be hosted by Robert Raymond. The talk is going to be...
Hello, my name is Robert Riemann, and it is the first time that I have the occasion to present at the State of the Map conference, and I'm very excited about it and happy that you tuned in. Please let me present my topic. I will speak about OpenStreetMap database, privacy risks and GDPR compliance, with some preliminary thoughts with focus on data contributors. But before I dive into the topic, let me please speak about the European Data Protection Supervisor for a brief moment. You can look up the EDPS on OpenStreetMap and you will find the offices are located in Brussels. There are many other EU institutions who also have their offices in Brussels. For instance, there is the European Commission headquarter that you see here on the right side, and also the European Parliament has a seat in Brussels. So the European Commission with 30,000 staff members is much larger than the small office of the EDPS. Currently, Wojciech Borowski is serving as the European Data Protection Supervisor. There are three principal mandates that the EDPS is fulfilling. First, monitoring and enforcing the protection of personal data and privacy when EU institutions and bodies process the personal information of individuals. Second, advising the European Commission and other EU bodies on legislative proposals and other acts with impact on data protection and privacy. And third, monitoring new technology that may affect the protection of personal information. For that, the EDPS disposes of a secretariat with about 100 staff members. So you see that's indeed rather a small institution. But of course, we try to be as vocal and has as much impact as possible. And this is why we are also happy to reach out and engage with communities such as OpenStreetMap. Before we go on with the talk, I would like to mention a few of the basics in data protection law. The talk is pretty much focusing on European Union data protection frameworks, but of course there are others, but many of them have very similar ideas, for instance, Japan and Canada. So in Article 4 of the European Union's General Data Protection Regulation, we have a number of definitions. The one on personal data, I find it very relevant, so let's just have a look at it. Personal data means any information relating to an identified or identifiable natural person. In that moment, we speak about that person as a data subject. But what is an identified natural person? It is one who can be identified directly or indirectly, in particular by reference to an identifier, such as a name, an identification number, or location data. Yeah, and many map applications process personal data. So for instance, when they locate their users, then they process the location of the user, which is personal data then. But also if you have a trip in a lonely desert somewhere and you download a specific map area, even though the location here is very coarse and it is not very clear if this is really the current location of the user, there are some information that can be inferred, and therefore this could also be personal data. And when you download the map area, also the IP address of your device is personal data because the device is linked to the user. And then again, search queries. So if I would search for all my hobbies, then of course all the hobbies that I have would allow other people to single me out to recognize me. And therefore also here personal data is involved. Generally, I believe that there are many privacy benefits for OpenStreetMap consumers. So let's take for example, a user that uses the mobile phone to look up a restaurant. First, the case on the left side where we consider a non-free mobile app. Often we see that telemetry data is sent to the app vendor And then again, the user, before even able to interact with the application, need to accept terms and conditions, or if it's a website, potentially cookies as well. So this has to be happened twice in many cases, not only for the app vendor, but also for the app store where the app has to be downloaded. So this is part of the mobile phone ecosystem that also comes with many conditions attached to it. Then again, when I look up where I am on the map, I share often the location with the app vendor, and queries are carried out online. And in the same moment, I will then receive also personalized services. And this can be ads, for instance, that are displayed within the map next to the results of my search query. But these apps don't only are displayed in the application, in the map, but also in other applications that are not related to the context in which I am. For instance, we can imagine that I first look up on Google Maps a new ice cream store. And then again, when I use YouTube, I will receive advertisements related to ice cream. And many people find that very little transparent. Then on the right side, I address the case where an OpenStreetMap-based offline free and open source software application is used. And here, the data, the map data is downloaded only once. Of course, there is a FOSS license that needs to be accepted, which offers much liberties to the users. And then the downside could be, of course, that I don't find the ice cream store because the owner did not care to register it in OpenStreetMap. But generally, we see that apps that rely on the exploitation of personal data as a business model are often less privacy friendly and sometimes not fully GDPR compliant. Second case is the one where maps are not directly consumed by a smartphone user, for instance, but are part of a company, an organization, it could be the private or the public sector, to deliver a service, either to staff members or to the customers. And here on the left side, I address again the case with proprietary map libraries. We could consider the ones from Google, Apple, Windows, but there are many others as well. Here, the company offering or integrating that map would need to have a contract with the map provider. This provider is then, in data protection terms, the data processor. If the map provider also receives or learns about personal data. And in that case, a data protection impact assessment may be required, where the company makes sure that the data processor is handling personal data in the map library with care. But often we see that the contracts that are offered by the libraries, by Google, Apple, Windows, or others, are not offering all the privacy safeguards that may be required from a legal perspective. So one example is, for instance, the recent EU's Schrems II judgment on personal data transfers. In that judgment, the European Court has found that there are a number of safeguards required when sending data to the United States. And this may require a different contract or to renegotiate the terms, but this may not often be possible. And on the other side, with OpenStreetMap data, it becomes possible to be more independent of proprietary map libs and instead either choose your own cloud provider where you can have a custom contract or to host even everything yourself. If you have a website and you embed your own maps here, you can also write your own privacy policy and do not need to consider the requirements imposed by third parties. So off-the-shelf map products that target the entire world are often more difficult to bring into GDPR compliance. Just one example, for instance, Google Maps comes often with the so-called IDE cookie that has as its purpose to deliver advertisement, personalized advertisement, and to do that, to process such data from customers, consent is an informed consent is required. It means people need to understand what this is really about. And this is often the task of the company to make sure that this consent is obtained from the customers. But we see many websites that do not do this very properly. The European Union is actually already using OpenStreetMap because of all these benefits. So here we see a website that shows the buildings of the European Commission in Brussels. And you can see that it uses underneath the data from OpenStreetMap, and it is even providing their own map tiles. That means everything is mirrored to the European Commission. I think they also double check the data and make sure for political reasons that some conflict areas are mapped accordingly to the policies. And then these map tiles are served and consumed by the websites of the European Commission and other EU institutions. To make OpenStreetMap even more useful for EU institutions, there are also volunteers who introduce special tags or conventions or discuss conventions and to map the offices of the EU institutions accordingly. So there's the idea to use, for instance, the tag or the property country equals European Union, but there's still a discussion ongoing if there are any better ways to accomplish that. Happy to hear your views on that wiki page. So let's now speak about the privacy risks for the OpenStreetMap contributors. The OpenStreetMap database contains a number of categories of personal data. And I have found a little bit information in the wiki about this, but also when using OpenStreetMap or contributing, this becomes evident. So the database is linking a number of categories to each other. So first we have, of course, in the database, map objects and their attributes. This could be, for instance, a shop and its opening hours. And if that object or attribute is added, it is added together with the username of the user who was tagging these elements. So here's the first link. And then because the shop has a location, we also can assume that the user may have been at that moment at that place. So there's also the user location involved. And there's also a timestamp of the actual mapping involved. And all this data allows to do a number of interesting things. There are websites that allow to understand better the activity, the mapping process, and to trace nearby contributors, for instance, or check out the analytics behind the mapping. And I think this leads to more categories of data that can be inferred. This may not be always 100% true, but even if it is very likely, this can lead to problems, to privacy risks. So, for instance, if I know when users have been active, I can understand their principal time zone. If I see where is the dominant area of the mapping activity, I can understand the home country, maybe the city, maybe even the address. If they then tag for 2 weeks in a very different area, I can assume this could be a business trip, or maybe they're on vacation and it's a vacation destination. If I see the vacation destination is always at the beach or always in the cities, I can understand maybe the habits. If I see they do a lot of tagging in ski areas, I could assume they like to do skiing. So there's much more information that can be read, that can be inferred from the database. Even more interesting are the special interests of the people that could be inferred. For instance, when they tag accessibility features, LGBT plus features, or dietary attributes. And these data are so-called special category data. They are related to health, to political views, and enjoy even higher levels of protection by the GDPR. And the obvious privacy risks here are, of course, targeted spying on or stalking off OpenStreetMap contributors by ex-partners, the boss, the teacher, other mappers, you name it. And another risk that I thought of would be profiling for whatever purpose. We just don't know, but as you have seen, much data for a profile could be inferred. Another aspect that I would like to address are school projects. So there was a wiki page that explains a number of activities in education, and here I have found two examples. Students have helped map various hometowns, or he spoke to students about geography as a discipline and as a career, then took them on an OpenStreetMap practical exercise in adding their houses to OpenStreetMap. And I think this can be actually very dangerous if not done in an appropriate way. Because when the students will add their own houses, it becomes evident where the students live. And students, if they are children, also enjoy a special protection by the GDPR. And for those that actually want to do such projects, I invite them to check out the GDPR recital 38, 58, Article 6, 8, and there may be even more that are relevant here. So I think it is a very good idea to teach students digital literacy and to take control over their data, to work with data, and it can also be OpenStreetMap. But I think it is a very bad idea to put metadata in OpenStreetMap that allows easily to infer personal data about children. Another aspect that I would like to cover is the relationship between personal data and public data. Because people may believe people have put their personal data in OpenStreetMap and therefore I can do with it whatever I want because it is anyway public. But this is not true. The GDPR applies to personal data if it is public or not. Processing of personal data, for instance metadata, in and from the OpenStreetMap database is subject to a number of principles stemming from data protection. So of course, there must be a legal basis. That means a reason why this can be legally processed. And examples here are consent. People have explicitly consented to this processing. There may be a contract, and there are also other legal bases that could be used. There's also purpose limitation that is required by GDPR. That means the data is collected for specified, explicit, and legitimate purposes and not further processed in a manner that is incompatible with them. And another interesting or important aspect is data minimization. So the processing is limited to what is necessary in relation to the purposes. And when I say processing here, it does not mean necessarily to do a very advanced analysis about it. Processing is already just storing data in a database and downloading it. Transferring data is also processing data. OpenStreetMap embraces the open data principle. That means, that's what I found on the website, you are free to use it for any purpose as long as you credit OpenStreetMap and its contributors. But this can be only partially true. You see the conflict with the GDPR's idea of purpose limitation. So I would sum up, free software licenses without purpose limitations are at odds with the GDPR. And this is certainly an interesting research topic with no final conclusion yet. But until we get there, I would recommend to try to avoid processing personal data if it is not really necessary. There are third parties that use OpenStreetMap data, and I have already mentioned in the previous slides a few websites. And for that purpose, OpenStreetMap Foundation has put into place a wiki page where data controllers can register so that data contributors could see who else is using their data. But as far as we can see here, so far nobody has ever registered. And I think here, that's too few, most likely. I'm very sure that it would be much better if there would be organizations who make sure that the data here, the list is as accurate and updated as possible. Of course, there are exceptions. There are other ways to comply with these rules than putting here an entry on this page. People can also be informed directly, but I can reassure you that I have already contributed in the past to OpenStreetMap and nobody have ever contacted me about processing of any personal data relating to me. So let us try to have an outlook. If OpenStreetMap offers strong privacy safeguards for data contributors, then I believe both contributors and consumers can profit a lot from a map service that does not rely on profiling and behavioral advertising and is therefore much different and a welcomed alternative for many people who value privacy a lot. But for that, OpenStreetMap must understand that privacy obligations stem from national laws and address them accordingly. OpenStreetMap should be very transparent on the purposes and practices of processing personal data. So I understand, for instance, that usernames and timestamps are very much needed in order to detect vandalism, for instance. But if this is done for every tagging, for every new mapping within the first year, maybe we don't need the data afterwards any longer. And this brings us to the overarching principles that OpenStreetMap should adhere to. Data minimization, for instance, and data retention. So when I do not need data for analyzing vandalism any longer, then it should be deleted. And OpenStreetMap should always aim for minimizing the data that they store. And for that, they can use various techniques. They could, for instance, work with pseudonymization and anonymization. Also, it should be very clear what is the purpose of the data that is maintained by OpenStreetMap. I think providing upfront information with various levels of detail to contributors and remind them potentially regularly on this would be a good idea. And then there must be also like a strategy on how the purpose could be limited. So I see when working with open data that this is complicated, and I'm sure that OpenStreetMap does already use some forms of authenticating APIs that offer personal data. But I think this is a really important aspect that deserves much attention. In the end, it may very well be that OpenStreetMap may need to change also current APIs and database layouts to make sure that their contributors are as good protected as the consumers when using OpenStreetMap. And of course, data protection authorities like the EDPS are here to help the people to ensure and to find good practices and protecting personal data. So I have not looked up where the OpenStreetMap Foundation has their main establishment within the European Union, but it is likely that a member state data protection authority would be here the competent authority to offer such a support. But of course, whenever this is about a European perspective, about research, I invite you also to contact me directly about any things related to OpenStreetMap via my email address, and then I will see if the EDPS on a best effort basis could also provide some support or at least point you to someone who would be able to do so. And now I'm already at the end of my talk. I hope you found it interesting, and I'm looking forward to have an interesting discussion with you. Thank you a lot.
So there's three questions. The first one is, do you have an opinion on if the Olsen Foundation strategy with respect to GDPR is sufficient or at least a step in the right direction, ignoring for now that nearly nothing has actually been implemented? So do you want me to read all the questions or you want to answer one by one?
I take them one by one, I think. So thank you already for the question and for the interest in the talk. Actually, I have prepared the talk and have received only afterwards actually a link to the strategy. So I was not aware of its existence before I prepared the talk. And I was pleasantly surprised that there actually has been already work on this topic, and I found the strategy very reasonable. And I think now it is important to put it into life and put it into action. I haven't seen anything that would disturb me in the strategy, but of course you can always do more. I think therefore implementing fully the strategy is the first step, and then one must again analyze if there have been any new risks emerging, or also if in the last 2-3 years since the strategy since the strategy has been crafted, if there were any updates actually to the legal situation. The Schrems II judgment that I just mentioned already is, for instance, one that has been published, I think, last year or the year before even. That would be something, for instance, that is not yet covered in the strategy as far as I remember.
Thank you. So the next question is, I recently learned that the GDPR only applies to living persons. How does this impact contribution and data about historical persons?
So I'm not sure if I get the question right. So it's about the location of the foundation and the location of the users. That's what I understood.
So the Kekstan said, I recently learned that the GDPR only applies to living persons. How does this impact contributions and data about historical persons?
To historical cousins? I don't get it, actually. I see.
Historical persons.
Generally, it's actually, I'm actually not a lawyer, so I do not want to give you a definitive answer to these legal questions. So I think this is the first aspect to it. What concerns the scope of the GDPR, it is that whenever data of EU citizens is processed or of people who reside, who live currently or are located in the European Union. And I think OpenStreetMap is a large project that just must assume that this situation may occur. And this is irrespectively where actually the foundation is hosted. Then of course, the question is, what about old data retrospectively? What about the personal data that has been added to the database before GDPR went into force? And I think there is no exception here. This is also covered by the GDPR, and of course, due to the transition, there may be problems that evolve from that, and one has to deal with this with a case-by-case analysis and see how to deal best with this. GDPR, though, does not apply to data of deceased people, but I think this should not be keeping OpenStreetMap of implementing the GDPR.
Okay. So is it in your opinion that OSM Foundation is at risk of violating GDPR by keeping only the email addresses of mappers that ask for their account to be terminated and deleted, except for their contribution? Do you think the consistency of the database and the check for genuineness of contributions should be warranted a legitimate interest act to add 6.1 of the GDPR?
That's also a legal question. I will just turn down all very specific legal questions. It is also not the European Data Protection Supervisor who would be then in the role to advise specifically on the implementation of the OpenStreetMap Foundation, as the European Data Protection Supervisor needs to reinsure to assure the processing of the EU institutions. So if the OpenStreetMap project is based in the UK, it would be the UK Data Protection Commissioner, the ICO office, who would be responsible to answer these questions. And of course, everything got a little bit more complicated due to the recent Brexit. So most likely, there will be another country that then is also responsible for the processing of the OpenStreetMap project within the European institutions. Could be, I think it's up to a choice also to some extent of the foundation. And if this country would be Belgium, it would be the Belgium Data Protection Authority. If it would be the Netherlands, it would be the Dutch Data Protection Authority, just to give some examples here.
Okay, so the other question is it acceptable to use multiple OSM accounts to mitigate any account having personal data for me? Although this puts responsibility on the OSMer, I have taught school children and given them throwaway account for the lesson.
Yeah, I think this already helps to avoid that profiles become very comprehensive and therefore is already one strategy, but I do not think that this is actually sufficient. Because in the end, there will still be one account that is taking possibly the house of a school kid. And then this is clearly personal data of children. And just because it is not evident for outsiders that this is a temporary account, a single use account, it's not like the obligations of the GDPR would not apply in here. I think one must also always understand the context. For instance, if all the school kids would use the same school network to register these accounts, it could also be possible to see from the IP addresses linked to the account that this was maybe a class exercise, a school exercise. And then again, it would be already possible to see, oh, this is children data and this is what the children have been done. Also, if they use throwaway accounts. Maybe I can give one idea. So what I think would be better if a teacher would offer its own account, for instance, her account, his account, and then the kids would use maybe that account to add data. And then there must be a way to make sure that the individual edits of the kids cannot be easily singled out from everything that the account was doing. But I mean, I'm just improvising here. It could be that there are also problems with this approach.
The other question is, how does the GDPR work on several chain datasets and copies of the database on all the servers worldwide? What should people that save that data be aware of?
Yeah, that's a very good question, because whenever you share the OpenStreetMap data that contains the metadata, that is personal data, to other countries worldwide and make it available public, then I think it is not only the GDPR that is relevant here, but actually also the data protection laws of many other countries. And large corporates have often, for this case, entire teams with lawyers that make sure that the organization can comply with all the different rules. I see this as a challenging situation for an NGO such as the OpenStreetMap Foundation. So the easiest solution here is, of course, to not distribute the metadata with the personal data and publish rather reduced data sets. And keep basically the personal data within the OpenStreetMap Foundation and have a very tough, very strict controls on who has access to this data. And the person who would access in this metadata, these personal data, would have undergone training, would explain the specific purpose for this access. And then this would need to be checked if this is a compatible purpose for given the original collection of the data. So there are some strategies, but I think when it is about publishing OpenStreetMap data, I think the solution here is just to make sure that the metadata is actually not published or only in a very limited way.
The second to last question is, do I understand it correctly that the GDPR relevant data is mainly tied to contribution records? So me downloading and working with data via the Overpass API, global, range, region, OSM file does not make me a data processor.
I think this is not entirely true, because you can also add queries to these searches, like the Overpass API, to query on elements, map data that has been added by a particular user. And in that moment, we immediately get personal data. In that moment, the link is already established between the individual user and between the objects tagged by the user. But of course, if the person would just use API queries that do not reveal personal data, for instance, avoiding to use queries for individual usernames, then I think no personal data potentially would here be involved. And that's already a good idea to avoid querying for usernames.
How does the OSM Foundation treatment of personal data compare to other open data projects like the Wikimedia?
I would say you're all in the same boat, because indeed Wikipedia has similar problems, because when people edit articles, we can already understand what are the interests of these people by the articles they edit. And also Wikimedia is keeping extensive metadata for the purpose of identifying malicious edits, similar to what OpenStreetMap is doing. So what I suggest is that actually the OpenStreetMap Foundation could partner up with other open data projects in order to work collaboratively on finding solutions to the very similar challenges with respect to privacy.
Last question. Is distributing the metadata only to logged in users Voodoo, or is it an effective control? A few OSM related sites have started doing that, requiring an OSM login to see personal data.
I don't think that this is very efficient, because everyone could just create an account and then have the entire access. So, of course, this gives you the chance to make people accept terms first. So you could put into the terms that people are not allowed to use the personal data for whatever purpose. But I think people would just click quickly an account and maybe not fully understanding or considering even these terms, and then the access is basically again public. So I don't think that the limitation to logged in users is very efficient here, but that's my personal view. So I think in the end, this is a rating exercise that would need to be done by the OpenStreetMap Foundation and by the data protection officer of the organization. And if there are doubts, it is a good practice, again, to ask a data protection authority for some advice. And this would then be, of course, written procedure and not someone, as I do, give you advice here in a video. That's a little bit lengthier as a procedure. And I think this is also what I would recommend for all the other legal questions. Try to come up with the questions. You can also ask the Wikimedia community if they have found already solutions. And then you could try to reach out to data protection authorities in writing in order to receive advice on how to protect the data here best and be compliant as good as possible.
Thank you so very much. These are the questions. I just want to remind the audience that they can still connect with you on the post-talk chat room. And if they have more questions, they can reach out to you. It was lovely to host your session. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. And see you in the post-session room.